Heaven is a good place, but the question is often asked, who will be allowed to go there? According to the Bible, not everybody is going. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount that many who thought that they would go will find out at the last that they're not going there at all. So how can you know for sure that you will have a place there? Stay tuned, we'll see.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossball. Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. Before we look at the subject, how can you know for sure that there will be a place for you in heaven? Let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we will read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank you for Bible prophecy that shows us what is going to happen in the future and how to be ready for it. And we earnestly pray that your Spirit will teach us the truth as we study from your word now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's free book is entitled Steps to Christ. To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer STC. Because of sin, mankind has been separated from God. So, to bring us back into connection with Himself, Jesus took upon Himself the burden of our sin and suffered and died in our place. To receive your free copy of Steps to Christ, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer STC. And now, Pastor John Grossball.
Heaven is a good place. The Bible says that people that go to that place, there's no more death. There's no more sorrow or crying, and there isn't any more pain. That is something that we endure in this world that they don't have in heaven. Not only that, in Isaiah 33:24, it says concerning that land, the inhabitant will not say, I am sick. Nobody will ever say they're sick. It's a wonderful place. It's a place where it says in Isaiah 35, it says, the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing, with everlasting joy on their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. It's a wonderful place. The question is, will you get to go? According to the words of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7, there are many people who would think that they're going that will wind up not being able to go to that place. Why is this? The New Testament makes it clear that there is something more required to go to heaven than making a profession of religion. The Apostle Peter, talking about this in 1 Peter 1, he says, as he who is called you is holy, so you be holy in all your conduct. That's in 1 Peter 1. The Apostle Paul is very emphatic about this. Look at what he says here in the book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter and the 14th verse. He says, pursue peace with all men and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Notice, the New Testament teaches then that if we are going to be in heaven, we must become holy people. Sometimes we use big words to describe it. We call it sanctification. And true sanctification or living holiness is a Bible doctrine. Here's what the Apostle Paul said about it in his letter to the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians 4:3. He said, this is the will of God, your sanctification. So sanctification is a Bible doctrine. Sanctification means holiness or holy living. And 1 Thessalonians 5:23, Paul wrote, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, the Bible here clearly teaches that sanctification involves the entire person, the soul, the spirit, and the body. Not only does the Bible tell us that we are to be sanctified, that is God's will for us, and we must be living holy, we must be having holy lives, we must be holy people if we are going to be in the kingdom of heaven, as we just read in Hebrews, the 12th chapter. But the Bible clearly tells us how that can happen. How can that happen in a person's life? A person that is a sinner, that has no capacity to do any good thing without help, how can that person become a holy person? Notice what Jesus said about it. This was one of His greatest desires for His followers. He mentions it in His last prayer just before He went into the Garden of Gethsemane, the night before He was crucified. Here in the Gospel of John, the 17th chapter, and verse 17, here's what Jesus said. Sanctify them by Your truth. Your word is truth. Notice, we are sanctified through the truth. We are not sanctified through erroneous doctrines or teachings. We can only be sanctified through the truth. And both Paul and Peter talk about sanctification as being accomplished through the power of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus left His disciples, before He left, He told them, He said that He was going to give them another Comforter, the Holy Spirit. And He said, when He comes to you, He will guide you into all truth. That's John 16, verse 13. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. Well, what is the truth? The Bible says your law is the truth. The law of God is the truth. That's Psalm 119, 142. So the Word of God and the Spirit of God open to men the great principles of righteousness that are embodied in God's law. And since the law is holy and just and good, you can read that in Romans 7, verse 12. Paul says the law is holy, just, and good. It is a transcript of the divine perfection. It follows then that if a person's character is formed in obedience to that law, that person will be a holy person. So you see, holiness is not complicated like a lot of people think. They think it's some ethereal thing that, well, oh, there's only a few saints that can be holy. No. According to the New Testament, every Christian can be holy and every Christian must be holy if that person is going to enter the kingdom of heaven. Remember, the Apostle Paul said, holiness, without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Jesus Christ was a perfect example of such a character. He says, I have kept my Father's commandments. He also said, I do always those things that please Him. That's John 8, 29. The first text was John 15, verse 10. Now, the followers of Christ are to become like Him. By the grace of God, they are to form characters that are in harmony with Christ's character, in harmony with the principles of God's law. This is what Bible sanctification is. A holy person, in simple language, a holy person is a person whose character, that is, their thoughts, their feelings, their words, and their actions, their character is in harmony with God's law, the Ten Commandments. An unholy person or a wicked person is a person whose character, their thoughts, their feelings, their words, their actions, are not in harmony with God's law, the Ten Commandments. It's just that simple. Now, how can this happen? How can a person who is a sinner, and as the Apostle Paul said in Romans 7, he says, I know that in me, that is in my flesh, there dwells no good thing. How can a person that in that condition become holy? It cannot happen without faith in Christ, trusting in Him, and without receiving the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about this in his letter to the Philippians. Philippians 2, verses 12 and 13. He says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for His good pleasure. The Christian will feel the promptings of sin from his sinful nature. But if a person is a Christian, that person will maintain a constant warfare against those sinful temptations that come either from without or from within. And that is where Christ's help is necessary. Human weakness can become united to divine strength. And when that happens, as the apostle says, thanks be to God who always gives to us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You can read that in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 57. Now, the scriptures plainly teach that the work of sanctification is progressive. It is not something that just happens in an instant. When a person becomes a Christian, they've been living a sinful life, but they decide to forsake their sinful life and follow Christ, and they become a Christian. When a person becomes a Christian, he finds peace with God through the blood of the atonement. But after he becomes a Christian, after he's baptized, his Christian life has just begun. Now the Bible says he is to go on to perfection, as you read in Hebrews 6. He is to grow up unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, as you can read in Ephesians 4:13. Here's the way the Apostle Paul described his own Christian experience, his own experience in becoming sanctified in the book of Philippians, the third chapter. Philippians, the third chapter, he says, starting in verse 12, not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, in other words, to accomplished it, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So, Paul said, this one thing I do, I press toward the mark. I press toward the mark of Christian sanctification, Christian perfection. The Apostle Peter gives us steps that can be followed to attain this Christian perfection, this Christian sanctification. Notice how the Apostle Peter describes this in 2 Peter, the first chapter. He says, His divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us to glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness or moral excellence, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. The Apostle Peter, in that passage, gives us the steps that a person can follow. He says, add to your faith virtue, moral excellence. And then he names different Christian virtues that we can develop. If a person is actually becoming a holy person, you will find that person will always be a humble person. Stay tuned. We'll see how and why that is.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own, without any help or guideline to follow, can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. If a person is really experiencing the sanctification that the Bible describes, that person will always be a humble person. Moses, who was a holy man, who was taken to heaven and is in heaven today. When he was speaking with the Lord, here's what he says. He says, "Do not let me see my wretchedness." And Daniel, who was also a man, who the angel said, "You are greatly beloved in heaven." Notice how he describes his situation in Daniel, the 9th chapter. He says, "We have sinned and committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from your precepts and your judgments. O Lord, to us belongs shame of face, to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, because we have sinned against you." Notice he includes himself with the people of Israel who have sinned against the Lord. And then in verse 15, he says, "Therefore the Lord has kept the disaster in mind and brought it upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in all the works which he does, though we have not obeyed his voice." And again in chapter 10, he says, "When I saw this great vision, no strength remained in me, for my vigor was turned to frailty to me, and I retained no strength." We see the same thing in the New Testament. Perhaps the most prominent, especially in the later years of the first century, the most prominent of the apostles was the Apostle Paul. He says that he was caught up to the third heaven and heard words which is not permitted for a man to utter. And yet when he describes himself, he says to the Ephesians, he said, "I am less than the least of all saints." And the Apostle John, when he talked to the Lord on the Isle of Patmos, you read it in Revelation, the first chapter, he said, "When I saw him, I fell as one dead." And then the Lord raised him up. So, humility is a characteristic of all holy people. We see it in both the Old and the New Testament. There is no self-exaltation. In fact, Jesus said, "The one who exalts himself will be abased." Why is that? The reason is that if a person is a holy person, they will feel that it was their sin which caused the agony that broke the heart of the Son of God. The Bible says that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And that will lead to self-abasement. A person who is living close to Jesus Christ will discern most clearly the frailty and the sinfulness of humanity, and the fact that their only hope of salvation is in the merits of Jesus Christ. But there are some people who believe that they can be sanctified in a moment, in a day, and as a result have a spirit of self-exaltation, and at the very same time, they disregard the law of God. This type of sanctification is foreign to the sanctification of the Bible. People believe that it's something that happens in an instant, and they say, "Only believe and it will happen." At the same time, they're saying this, they're denying the authority of the law of God. Why is this? How did this kind of theology develop? Well, it has developed as a result of the desire for an easy religion. An easy religion that requires no striving, no self-denial, no divorce from the follies of the world. That has made the doctrine of faith and faith only a popular doctrine. But what does the Word of God say about this? Notice what the Apostle James says about it in James 2 and the 14th verse. He says, "What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him?" And then he says, "Do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. and he was called the friend of God. You see, then, that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. So the testimony of the Word of God is against the ensnaring doctrine of faith without works. It is not really faith that claims the favor of heaven without complying with the conditions laid down in the Bible, the conditions upon which mercy is granted. If you're claiming the promises of the Bible, but you're not complying with the conditions of those promises, that is not faith, that is presumption. Genuine faith has its foundation in the promises and provisions of the Scripture. So, we must not deceive ourselves with the idea that we can become holy while at the same time we are violating willfully one of God's commandments, one of His requirements. The commission of a known sin silences the witnessing voice of the Holy Spirit in the conscience and separates a person from God. Sin, of course, is the transgression of the law, 1 John 3:4. And the Scripture says that anyone who sins has not seen Him and doesn't know Him. You can read that in 1 John 3:6. Now, the Apostle John in his epistles dwells largely upon love. He dwells fully upon it, but he does not hesitate to reveal the true character of those persons who claim to be sanctified while they are living in transgression of the law of God. Notice what he says here in 1 John 2, verses 4 and 5. He says, "He who says, 'I know him,' and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him." This is the test of your profession and of my profession. We cannot be holy unless we bring our lives into harmony with the law of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. We cannot make light of any one of God's requirements or break the least of His commandments and teach someone else so if we want to be holy. Any holiness that we have or claim to have will be without foundation. Some people say, "Well, I am free of sin." The apostles and the apostles did not make claims like that. Notice what the Apostle John says about that claim in 1 John 1. He says, "If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and the truth is not in us." So a person who is sanctified in this world will never claim to be holy or without sin. We do not find any of the apostles or prophets making claims like that. In fact, the patriarch Job, whom God said was a perfect man, when the Lord revealed Himself to him in Job 42, Job says, "I repent in dust and ashes." If we have a concept of the infinite purity and holiness of God and the exalted loveliness of the character of Jesus and the malignity and evil of sin, we will not be able to regard ourselves as holy. We will look upon ourselves as sinners who are in need of saving grace and the reception of the Holy Spirit, a transformation of character. The sanctification or holiness that is described in the Scriptures involves the entire person, the entire being, as we read a few minutes ago in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it involves the spirit, the soul, and the body. Jesus warned us that we should be careful of having a religion that we think will make us holy, but does not make us holy because we are not following the principles, the teachings in the Bible. Jesus went into some detail about this in Matthew, the 7th chapter. He said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate, and difficult or restricted is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it." You see, in the broad road, you can take along any sin that you please. You can just do what comes naturally. You can live however you please. You're on the broad road. You can take all your baggage with you. But if you want to go up the narrow road that leads to life, you must leave your sins at the gate. You must be willing to forsake sin and follow Jesus in holy living. And Jesus dwells upon this in detail in the latter part of Matthew, the 7th chapter, and he tells us that there will be many people in the last days who will consider themselves to be Christians and consider that they are saved, but they will come right up to the end of the world when the Lord comes, and then they will tell the Lord that they're saved, but the Lord will contradict them. This is the way Jesus said the conversation would go. He said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?' And then Jesus says, 'I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.' May that not be said to you." Thank you for joining us for today's program. Locally and worldwide, people are blessed by our offers of free Bible studies and free booklets because of your support. Our ministry is funded by God's children. If the Holy Spirit impresses you to send a gift to Steps to Life, you can send to Steps to Life, Post Office Box 782828, Wichita, Kansas, 67278. Or you can donate by calling our 800 number, 1-800-THE-TRUTH, or by visiting our website.
We hope you've enjoyed today's program. Today's free book is entitled Steps to Christ. To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer STC. Because of sin, mankind has been separated from God, and it is impossible for us of ourselves to escape from sin. So, to bring us back into connection with Himself, Jesus took upon Himself the burden of our sin and suffered and died in our place. The price of our redemption should give us exalted conceptions of what we may become through Christ. To receive your free copy of Steps to Christ, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer STC. From all of us here at Steps to Life Ministries, may God richly bless you as you seek for His truth.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. Steps to Life is supported by your donations. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas, 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org. And our web address is www.stepstolife.org.